Boston's Police Commissioner Michael Cox is here this morning. Let's go on the record. He's gone from street cop to talk cop, but how is he navigating both an evolving city and an ever-changing role for law enforcement? The commissioner's in the chair this morning. It's time to go on the record.
From WCVB Channel 5, the inside word from Washington to Beacon Hill. Today's newsmakers are going on the record.
Welcome to OTR, everyone. I'm Ed Harding, along with News 5's political reporter, Sharmin Zaccheddi. It's great to have you with us this morning. And as you can see this morning, Boston's Police Commissioner Michael Cox is with us. He became the 44th commissioner of BPD last August. Prior to that, he served as police chief in Ann Arbor, Michigan. He began his career with the BPD and is a native of Boston. He holds degrees from Providence College, Curry College, and BU. It's great to have you with us, Commissioner. Thanks for your time.
Oh, thank you for having
me. See you.
Thanks for being here. So we want to start with some news that happened this past week, the botched FBI training mission at a Boston hotel. Now, the room of an airline pilot was wrongly raided. That pilot had to call Boston police for help. Were Boston police aware that this kind of training was taking place in sort of a public place?
Man, that's a good question. So I think the issue for us is a lot of cities, towns, other agencies come into our city and they do make us aware that they're coming in. But, you know, I don't know if they made us aware about their training, but it's likely that they probably did at some point. Yes.
All right. And mm-hmm. So do you feel like agencies like the FBI or the Department of Defense, you feel like they typically keep you in the loop?
You know, a lot of, particularly in law enforcement, when they do things in certain jurisdictions, it's natural courtesy to let people know that they're doing that and you know, in your jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of expected, but from time to time that doesn't happen. And then usually if something happens, then usually you would hear from it.
And in this case, something did happen. It was the wrong room. This person was not the person who was playing the role in that particular case. Mm-hmm. So what's the proper response to what happened there?
Well, so I don't know what happened, and it's under investigation, and I believe that, you know, both the Department of Defense, probably the FBI, is doing their own investigation. So it's probably not appropriate for me to comment on what went wrong, because, you know, we weren't there, and I have no idea mm-hmm. or what went wrong. But it was a training exercise,
right.
and training exercises are, you know, are needed, and particularly in when you're talking about enforcement things in general. And so I don't want to speculate what happened, but the fact is something did happen, and clearly something went wrong that maybe, you know, should not have happened in that way.
Still sort of a gray area as to whether or not Boston police were notified about this.
Well, notified about the actual event, and so I will, without having knowledge, probably say that they mm-hmm. probably did say, hey, mm-hmm. by the way, courtesy that we're mm-hmm. doing an exercise in your jurisdiction around that. So I will say that, but, you know, I can't confirm it right now.
You know, someone was handcuffed to a sink in the bathroom or mm-hmm. whatever it was. I mean, that's...
Well, we weren't notified about that part,
okay.
right?
Okay.
So I mean, that's, I mean, I don't know. That's an investigation with another agency, a federal agency, and I'm confident that they will get to the bottom line of what occurred, and they'll probably talk about it.
Item two, the thing I'd like to talk about is we are now, here it is Sunday, we're just over a week away from a major event, not only in the city, but on the calendar, period, not just the sports calendar, the 127th running of the Boston Marathon, marking, of course, the world's oldest, longest running marathon in and of itself, and of course it marks 10 years since what happened in the marathon bombings. Truly the eyes of the world are always on Boston. They will be on Boston on a week from tomorrow. Safety is everyone's prime concern. So I know you can't reveal everything, but your department's readiness, because you're the largest city in the marathon.
We are the largest city, but the good thing is the marathon has a long history of us working with multiple agencies, because it doesn't start and end in Boston.
Right.
It starts, you know, certainly in Hopkinton and goes all the way into Boston. So we work with many different municipalities. We have federal partners, state police. You know, we have a whole host of law enforcement agencies, including federal, that are involved in making sure that it's a safe event. And I'm confident that going into it, that we're doing all we can to continue to make sure that it's a safe event.
And this is your first marathon as commissioner, but this is not your first marathon.
No, this is not my first marathon. This would be my, I don't know, 30-something marathon in that
way. Oh, really? Yeah.
But yeah, so, we are doing all we can to make sure it's safe. We do that by partnering with other agencies and using all the resources we have to do our due diligence to make sure we're prepared for anything that happens.
In the wake of the bombings 10 years ago, mm-hmm. we were reminded that a marathon event is a soft target, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you're outside, you're involving eight cities and towns between Hopkinton and Boston. So it's a large target and a soft target, which makes it a difficult target.
It is a large space to cover. in that way, but we've been doing it for a long period of time, and so, you know, we're confident that our plan is certainly robust, and everyone should know coming in that it's always going to be a family-friendly event, and we're going to do all we can to make sure everyone is safe. And so this year will be, you know, no different. We've learned, you know, quite a few lessons. We've adjusted over the years around safety. And so, you know, without getting too much into our plans, we recognize that we've tweaked it almost every year in some way, shape, or form, and we'll continue to do that to make sure we evolve to keep everyone safe.
All right, let's talk about one of your primary challenges, which is fighting violent crime in the city. 11 homicides since the beginning of the year, up 5 from the same period in 2022. None more tragic than the shooting death of a 13-year-old boy, Tyler Lawrence, in Mattapan. There has been criticism that the city has not done enough to keep neighborhoods of color safe. What is your response to that?
You know, as a city, I mean, you know, Boston is one of the safest cities in America, period. And our crime statistics show that. And our crime statistics even show, even within Boston over the years, where we've gotten safer and safer every single year. You know, that being said, when someone dies, you know, for the family, for the community, you know, that's too much. One death is too much. And so, you know, we're always looking to improve to the point where we have zero deaths, if that can happen. We're trying to make sure that happens. But I think it's important for people to understand that we're working hard. Law enforcement has a role. We're doing all we can to make sure we live up to that role. Mm-hmm. But safer communities exist when everyone in the community is involved around the safety of that community, whether it means, you know, talking or telling us things, whether it means, you know, the community just stepping up, knowing their neighbors, you know, just being more active in their neighborhood in general. And so, you know, we're partnering with everyone in the city to make sure Boston is the safest city, not only in America, but in the world.
Well, let me expand on that a few. You know, you spent time with the mayor, obviously, but you were with Mayor Wu last week for a gathering with the mayor on community safety and reaching out into the neighborhoods. School Superintendent Mary Skipper was also there, and you've spoken of the importance of police role in schools, police role in schools is a delicate balance, is it not?
Yeah, and I don't want to be misquoted as that. I think we have a role in all parts of the site because we have a safety role. So it's whether we're educating people on how to stay safe or giving guidance or just making sure that we understand the needs of, you know, each segment of the community or where they're from. And so I think we always have a role in that. You know, our role is not to, you know, walk the hallways of the school department, you know, arresting kids. No, that is not our role in any way, shape, or form. But we are there to provide safety, whether it's around training, to make sure, you know, school shootings are a thing in this country, you know, and so any way that we can help make sure the environment is safe, I think we have a role in that.
Should there metal detectors be everywhere around school entry points?
You know, that is up to the school and the school department if they, you know, choose to.
Does the commissioner think that would help?
You know, metal detectors serve a purpose, and the purpose is to detect if someone has a weapon or not, whether they're coming in this building. I don't know if you have it in this building, but a lot of buildings
do. We do not, for the record, by
correct.
The way. We do not.
You know, a lot of places do have that, but that's up to the individual to make those calls. It's not up to the police to dictate whether people have metal detectors in there. So, our role is to provide public safety and, you know, to give advice on things that can help people stay safe. But it's up to the individuals, you know, what they want to choose to do. We work with the school department. I don't want to give the impression that the schools are out there on their own. We work daily with the schools. We will respond. There's a plan in place right now if something happens to make sure that we're there to keep kids safe. I think sometimes that's been lost here when the people, it seems like, oh, there's no connection. We have a connection, a strong connection, and the superintendent is, you know, her and I, you know, have a great relationship, and we're working to actually create an MOU between the two parties to define what those roles are, because that's important, I think, for the school department and for our officers when we go into a school.
I want to ask you about numbers of police officers right now, about 1,600 officers on the force right now. The Patrolman's Union would like that number to be closer to 2,000. Do you feel like you have enough police right now to get the job done?
So, you know, from a public perspective, perception. You know, we are here. Regardless of the number we have, we're going to be out there. We're going to be visible.
Right, you're going to show up. But the question is, do you think you have enough?
Well, enough for what? You know, this is a major city. If we continue to, you know, put on major events, if we continue to grow in size, if we continue to do things, then you have to readjust and evaluate our numbers around that. And so it's always in comparison, enough for what? You know, for the marathon coming up, you know, it's an all-out. Every officer will be working for that event. And so the city will be safe. So it's the issue of how many events, you know, how often, mm-hmm. how big, mm-hmm. you know, then that's when you start to get into those. Mm-hmm.
I want to ask you briefly about recruiting mm-hmm. officers, because that's something you've been vocal about. It's not necessarily, you've said there's been a loss of love for this job.
Yeah, nationwide, I mean, you can't go through a long period of time like you've seen where there's been day in, day out, criticism of all police in general. It doesn't matter where you are or your involvement in an activity. It's just the mere fact that you are on this job. It's been certainly quoted and said by many, you know, forms of media that, this is not a good job, a good place. And so that makes it difficult to attract people, particularly young people. This job is, you come on very young on the police departments, particularly in Boston, and you stay almost 32 years. And so young people are very impressionable. They mm-hmm. don't want to go a place where nobody likes, you know, that particular profession. And that's, not appropriate. And it's, we're needed. We'll always will be needed. And the fact is we should be able to attract people.
Should the city get rid of the residency requirement? Yes or no? What do you think?
That's a political question. Yeah. And, you know, my job is to make sure that we field a team and not really get into politics. Any impediment to recruiting, makes it difficult. Mm. Right now, our biggest impediment is not residency, it's perception. Our biggest impediment is about, the perception of police. This is a noble profession. People sign on to help people when they come on this job. But the reality is, that's not the rhetoric that's out there.